It truly is remarkable at just how many ancient sites exist on Earth that you've never seen or heard of before. I mean, for most anyone, when we think of lost ancient civilizations, we think of sites such as the pyramids of Egypt or perhaps the Great Sphinx. We think of the circular arrangement of stones that make up Stonehenge in England. We may think of ancient South American sites including Machu Picchu or perhaps the enormous as well as mysterious puzzle of stones that make up the Sacsayhuaman wall in Peru. Or maybe we think of ancient Aztec or Mayan civilizations and the pyramids that are found in Mesoamerica. But of course, for people that are more familiar with the topic of lost ancient civilizations, essentially people who research it for fun in their spare time, for them, other lesser-known sites may come to mind. Such as the 12,000-year-old site of Göbekli Tepe in Turkey, the world's oldest known megalithic site, which is a total mystery. Or perhaps they think of Angkor Wat in Cambodia, a very large and impressive site that wasn't even rediscovered till the mid-1800s. And I'm sure some people may think of the lost city of Petra located in Jordan. Too few people are aware of this incredible site, which is mostly known for its brief appearance in the final scene of Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. So although some of the sites I just mentioned aren't known by, say, a majority of people, there are other sites around the world that are unknown to virtually almost anyone, which I'll be sharing with you in this video. In fact, these details I'm about to share with you will really get your mind thinking about how much we don't know about our ancient past, and more importantly, just how much is waiting to be discovered around the world and within our lifetimes. Let me start off with an example that you may have seen in the news just this past week, which was the fascinating discovery of lost ancient ruins in Mosul, Iraq, which was hidden and unknown for at least 3,400 years. It had been submerged underwater all that time in a reservoir created by the Tigris River. That was until a substantial drought dried up much of the reservoir and exposed the ruins of what was once an ancient palace. The significance of this discovery cannot be overstated, as it illustrates that so much of our ancient past has been hiding right under the noses of modern civilization. But what makes this discovery even more interesting is the fact that it is located in the so-called Cradle of Civilization, the land between two rivers, the Tigris and the Euphrates, the ancient biblical region known as Mesopotamia, a land that holds so much of our ancient past yet continues to be an archaeological mystery, largely unable to be explored by outsiders for a variety of reasons. And speaking of ancient biblical cities, you may be curious to see the modern-day locations of places that are cited in the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, as well as the Quran. These countries include Iraq, Iran, Israel, Palestine, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Lebanon, Sri Lanka, Sudan, and Yemen, and there's likely others as well. So as you look at this, reflect on the fact that at one point, just a few thousand years ago, this whole region of the globe was home to widespread ancient civilizations, a time when this massive desert region was lush and green, but is now buried under the sands of time. But of all of these countries, Iraq is perhaps the most prominent when it comes to notable locations of ancient history, as it was home to the Sumerians, Assyrians, and Babylonians. Think about that. Modern-day Iraq is the location of the world's oldest documented civilization that we are aware of, which is the ancient Sumerians out of Sumer. Now, the Sumerians are the topic of so much debate, as the mysterious clay tablets that they left behind truly make you wonder what they were trying to tell us. In fact, these tablets raise many questions as to what they may have known about the cosmos, which should not have been possible until several thousand years later. For example, the highly debated solar system tablet, as it's commonly referred to as, raises a big question, which is, did people 6,000 years ago know of all the planets within our own solar system, as well as the fact that they orbited around the sun and not around the Earth? Something that Copernicus did not figure out for another 5,000 or so years. And by the way, these tablets were found in the ancient city of Uruk, located in modern-day Iraq. But Sumerian tablets aside, Iraq is truly an archaeologist's dream, but has been virtually off-limits to archaeologists and outside researchers for decades, which is so unfortunate, as many of the oldest relics of ancient civilization that have ever been found have been under the sands of the Iraqi desert and undoubtedly countless more are waiting to be found. Let's not forget that the Assyrian winged bulls, also referred to as the Lamassu, originate from Iraq as well. These massive statues, carved out of granite and even quartzite, are half bull, half human, and have wings. A truly impressive sculpture, several dozen of which have been found, and actually I think more than 100 have been found, and have since been dispersed among museums all over the world. But unfortunately, many of the ones that were kept on location have since been destroyed in the wake of devastating instability in the region. Very upsetting, to say the least. However, I was fortunate enough to personally see and touch these same exact relics back in 2010. And these are my own photos, that is me in the picture. Some of you are aware that I was in the army and served a nearly 1 year long deployment to Iraq, including the city of Mosul, which is the ancient city of Nineveh from the Old Testament. I'll be sharing more photos and video clips that I took while at this site later in this video for those of you who are interested. But first, I must connect the dots on a variety of fascinating details that will show you just how many ancient sites are waiting to be discovered all over the world. Whether it's ancient historical ruins and artifacts that are still buried in the sands of time, or even relics that are currently submerged under the ocean. I'll be sharing a few examples of that in a moment, but what's crazy is that there are unbelievably impressive ancient monolithic sites that are not buried at all, found in the absolute middle of nowhere, which most people have never even heard of. A fantastic example of this ties into the lost city of Petra, which is in modern-day Jordan. I made a video on this topic about a year ago in which I showed you the incredible structures that were carved right out of the side of a mountain, some of which exceed 150 feet in height, or nearly 50 meters. Just compare the size of these structures to people. Compare them to the massive doorways. Simply incredible. In fact, look at the person standing nearly at the top on the right-hand side and see how small he is in comparison. And if you've ever been interested in what's actually inside of these structures, check out my video on this where I actually show you what's inside, because for some reason, most documentaries on the topic of Petra seem to completely ignore the interior altogether. It's strange, and I was actually blown away at just how many comments I received on that video of people saying that they had never even known what the interiors of these so-called temples look like. But that aside, did you have any idea that whoever constructed this site also did so in other places as far away as Saudi Arabia and even Iran? Just look at these impressive stone structures in the remote Saudi Arabia desert, found in the middle of nowhere. Now consider the distance of this site from Petra, which is nearly 300 miles or almost 500 kilometers away. Were you aware of any ancient ruins in Saudi Arabia? I was surprised when I first learned of this site, wondering why I hadn't heard of it sooner. And like I said, there are other similar sites, clearly made by the same people and the same tooling method, all the way over in Iran. Were you aware of this site either? And get this, from Petra to this site in Iran is more than 1,000 miles away, or closer to 1,700 kilometers. And for additional comparison, the site in Saudi Arabia is over 900 miles away from the site in Iran, or nearly 1,500 kilometers. Between the distance of these sites and the complexity to construct them, this is evidence of a widespread, sophisticated civilization. Yet, we have so little evidence and answers about these mysterious sites. It is truly unknown who constructed them or when. However, modern academics and historians do credit the Nabataeans, who were a nomadic tent-dwelling civilization that was said to be rich in trade, and they claim that they must be responsible for constructing Petra as well as these sites in Saudi Arabia and Iran. They believe that all of these sites were built for the purposes of being tombs and places of worship. But in fact, there really is no evidence to credit the Nabataeans for constructing this, and I regret to say that it's just another example of a copped-out explanation made up by people, i.e. academics and people who write textbooks, who are too afraid or are unwilling to simply say that I don't know who did this or when. But that debate is not what this video is about, and I discussed this in more detail in my original Petra video, so again, I recommend that you check that out. But the point is this. There are incredible ancient structures in existence that so few people even know exist. They're not buried, they're not under the ocean, they're right in the open, albeit in the middle of nowhere in the desert, and they are unbelievably impressive, marvels of ancient human ingenuity. But it is worth mentioning that the authorities within Saudi Arabia actually kept this place secret by preventing its citizens, as well as outsiders, from visiting these sites up until just several years ago. So undoubtedly, that greatly contributed to the lack of exposure that these amazing sites have had to the outside world. But Petra and the connections to ancient sites in Saudi Arabia and Iran aside, and keeping in mind the example of the recently discovered ruins in Iraq that was once above water and thriving some 3,500 years ago, the question now becomes, what else is waiting to be found in this region? A fantastic illustration of this involves a study that was published stating that a once fertile landmass is now submerged beneath the Persian Gulf and may have been home to some of the earliest human populations outside of Africa. An archaeologist who was cited in this article stated that the area in and around this, quote, Persian Gulf oasis, may have been host to humans for over 100,000 years before it was swallowed up by the Indian Ocean around 8,000 years ago. In other words, the Persian Gulf was above water for possibly 100,000 years up until just several thousand years ago. Now combine that with the point that I've made in many other videos, which was that global sea levels had a sudden and rapid rise at the end of the last ice age, particularly around 12,000 to 13,000 years ago, very likely related to the overwhelming evidence that an asteroid or comet hit the North American ice shelf at that time, thus causing the surge in sea level rise. And considering that so much of the world's population lives on or near a coastline for its resources, especially in ancient times, we must come to grips with the obvious fact that much of what's left of those ancient civilizations are now at least a couple hundred feet under the ocean. Think about that. So again, consider the regional location of the Persian Gulf and how we already know that so much of our ancient past is in this same region. What on earth could be waiting to be discovered at the bottom of the Persian Gulf, perhaps only a few feet or meters beneath the sands that cover the ocean bottom? And by the way, the Persian Gulf today has an average depth of 164 feet or 50 meters and a maximum depth of 295 feet or 90 meters. So these depths are well within the 400 foot sea level rise that occurred since the height of the last ice age. The implications of this strongly suggest that what is now the Persian Gulf, as recently as 8,000 years ago, became the burial grounds for what may have been a massive and now lost ancient civilization, just as scientific researchers that published a study on the matter suggested. We really need to take a step back and remind ourselves that so much of our oceans is yet to be explored. In fact, the most recent estimates by NOAA state that more than 80% of our ocean is, quote, unmapped, unobserved, and unexplored. This is so unfortunate, and most people do not even realize just how little we know about our own oceans. I mean, here's a random thought to think about with our modern day mindsets, which is that it's been more than 5 years since the disappearance of MH370, a massive 777 jetliner that we still cannot find, despite all of our modern technology being used to look for it. And a Boeing 777 is larger than many ancient ruins, so although a missing jetliner may not be the best comparison, I think you see what I'm getting at here, which is that looking for anything in the ocean is like looking for a needle in 1 million haystacks. So what else of our ancient history could be hidden under the ocean waiting to be discovered? Yet virtually no one is actually looking for lost ancient submerged ruins. Hell, most people don't even know of the awkward fact that the massive 90-mile-wide Chalixa Club crater that is credited to the extinction event that wiped out the dinosaurs was only found because engineers working for a petrol company were mapping the ocean floor while exploring for oil reserves. You know, it really sucks when you realize that so much ocean floor mapping is only being done by treasure hunters looking for gold in sunken pirate ships, and then there's the oil and gas industry looking for more fuel to sell us. And the study that suggests that there is a lost civilization at the bottom of the Persian Gulf is not the only example of possible civilizations that are now submerged by the ocean. In fact, the BBC reported on a possible discovery of a submerged civilization back in 2002, when a team of marine scientists claimed to have discovered ancient ruins some 36 meters or 120 feet underwater in the Gulf of Cambay off the west coast of India, and would date back to more than 9,000 years ago if confirmed. And get this site was only discovered by chance when oceanographers from India's National Institute of Ocean Technology were conducting a survey of pollution in the water. And through using side-scan sonar, which sends a beam of sound waves to the bottom of the ocean, they identified geometrical structures at a depth of 120 feet. Now, I have not researched this enough to come to my own conclusions. I don't know all of the information about it, so as always, I encourage you to research things on your own, but I was thrilled to see that Graham Hancock was quoted in this article, so let me read to you what he said. Quote, "The oceanographers found that they were dealing with two large blocks of apparently man-made structures." He went on to say that cities on this scale are not known in the archaeological record until roughly 4,500 years ago, when the first big cities began to appear in Mesopotamia. Nothing else on the scale of the underwater cities of Cambay is known. The first cities of the historical period are as far away from these cities as we are today from the pyramids of Egypt. Now, of course, this site is highly debated, but I found it quite humorous that the first reason that the skeptics gave for dismissing this site was to say that, hey, this is 9,000 years ago, you're saying, there were no civilizations around at that time that could have done this, so there's no way that these structures could be man-made. End of story. Okay. But the reality is that the Gulf of Cambay was indeed above water and on the coastline just several thousand years ago, like the Persian Gulf. And this site just so happens to have multiple stone blocks that really do appear to have man-made cuts. So, at a minimum, this site needs to be further studied. Not dismissed by closed-minded people who are too focused on memorizing their textbooks. Now, there are other fascinating underwater cities that have been found around the world that are worthy of discussion, so I look forward to making an entire video on this subject in the future for sure. But lost ancient civilizations that are waiting to be found under the ocean is one thing. Meanwhile, there are ancient ruins waiting to be discovered on land right now around the world, but far more so than you might think. So think of it like this. Egypt is, without a doubt, the most abundant and widespread stash of ancient relics and ruins anywhere on Earth. Whether it's the discovery of incredible tombs containing ancient Egyptian mummies, or between the countless carved statues located throughout Egypt, and all of the incredible stonework and columns and obelisks, and not to mention all of the pyramids, which different sources providing the total number of Egyptian pyramids exceeds 100. That's right, there are many pyramids more than just the ones that you see on the Giza Plateau. But pyramids aside, the discoveries of ancient Egyptian artifacts continues to happen. You'll likely remember last year's discovery of a massive black box sarcophagus that made international headlines, with everyone trying to guess what was going to be found inside of it. Well, don't forget that this was found in the middle of the dense Egyptian city of Alexandria, and was only discovered because of a construction project happening on a building that was built upon it. And not only that, it was already buried 16 and a half feet, or 5 meters, into the earth. This was a fluke discovery. So it begs the question of what else is waiting to be discovered, not only in the direct vicinity of this finding and elsewhere in Alexandria, but elsewhere in the country. What else is buried 5 meters under the sands of Egypt? Because this reminds me of the massive 3,000-year-old statue that was discovered 2 years ago, buried in a slum in the Egyptian city of Cairo, which was, again, only discovered by accident. Think about the implications of these fluke discoveries. It means that there is an unfathomable amount of ancient ruins, relics, and artifacts waiting to be discovered underneath any modern city in Egypt. Because this is already happening. People are digging underneath their own homes in Egypt to find and sell Egyptian artifacts on the black market. And apparently this is so common now that it is a multi-billion dollar a year industry. Occasionally, there will be a bust of people that possess tens of thousands of artifacts that were illegally looted from sites that haven't even been documented, such as underneath homes and other structures that people own. It's disturbing, isn't it, to think that so much history is being robbed, never to be recorded or documented, simply to end up in the possession of some rich prick that will keep it for themselves, never to be seen by the public. I mean, I can wrap my head around people digging under their own homes and search for artifacts. I mean, I get it. But let's not forget that there has long been black market activity within the Antiquities Department of Egypt, the same people that are supposed to protect these sites. You may remember the allegations made against Zahi Hawass, strong claims of black market activity at the highest level, and although that example was a few years ago and he lost his job since, he is certainly not out of the picture. In fact, let me show you something that's pretty hilarious, although, well, it's really not that funny at all, but take a look at this. What I happened to see while browsing the United Airlines magazine a few weeks ago while on a flight, I was flipping through the pages and saw this. An advertisement for a luxurious tour group conducted by Zahi himself. Yep, that's right. And by the way, I can only imagine how much he paid to have this advertisement published in the monthly edition of United Airlines magazine, something that would ultimately be seen by many millions of people from around the world. But whatever, good for him, I guess, right? Maybe I should sign up and go on one of his tours, huh? Ask a bunch of questions. Something tells me I would definitely get kicked out of that one. But getting back to the point that there is so much buried and waiting to be discovered from our Asian past, keep in mind that it's not just this region of the world either. Let's not forget about last year's incredible discovery of a massive Mayan civilization in a remote region of the Guatemalan jungle. While utilizing airborne LiDAR and 3D mapping, scientists were able to penetrate the lush jungle floor and see what lies buried underneath it. This discovery was so massive that they estimated that this so-called megapolis that they found could have been home to 10 to 15 million people, with their largest previous estimates being only 5 million people. What makes this discovery so incredible is that this same exact land had already been surveyed on foot, but none of it was seen or known to exist. Even a pyramid was right under the feet of explorers that had walked this same land. But only through the latest technology could they find and identify this incredible game-changing discovery. Just look at the pictures as seen on the ground compared to what is actually there. This is a profound example that should illustrate to all of us the potential discoveries that are waiting to be found throughout the world. Now, I look forward to making future videos on topics like these of little-known discoveries that are absolutely fascinating from around the world, and that will fill up other videos in the future for sure. But since this is getting a bit long, I want to jump into my experience with these Assyrian winged bulls while I was in Iraq. Like I mentioned earlier in this video, the ancient city of Nineveh was the Assyrian Empire's oldest and most populous city. It is also the biblical location for where Jonah went immediately after he was allegedly swallowed by the whale. I had the fortunate privilege of being in the right place at the right time while on deployment in Iraq while stationed in Mosul to be able to see this in August of 2010. And I must say that this site is absolutely incredible. An ancient city surrounded by a tall 25-plus-foot wall. In fact, just compare the size of this burnt-out van at its base. That type of van is taller than most people, and yet it is dwarfed by this defensive wall. The wall surrounds the city, and in total there are 15 entrance gates that surrounded a city that has an area of approximately 7 square kilometers, or nearly 3 square miles. And here you can see a satellite image of that area. And real quick, let me show you a short 45-second video clip that I personally filmed while occupying the gunner's turret in an up-armored vehicle as our convoy was leaving the Nergal Gate, which is on the north side of the perimeter of the Nineveh city. In this clip, you can also see a second gate on the north side, which is called Adad, named after the Sumerian god. But also notice the size of the wall in this video clip and compare to the vehicles at its base. Again, it's about 45 seconds. Here we go. Of course, the video quality wasn't that great, but I hope it kind of gave you an idea of the surrounding area, and I'm actually going to show you another video clip of me on the ground in just a moment. But first, what you're looking at here is the Nergal Gate, like I just mentioned, named after the Sumerian god. In fact, all 15 entrances of this city are named after Sumerian gods, and This is just one of the reasons why I wonder if the so-called Assyrian winged bulls actually date back to the Sumerians. Of course, the Assyrians were the civilization that followed the Sumerians in this exact region, but whether these bulls are actually Sumerian is certainly debatable, and I look forward to expanding on that in a future video. But something else that you should be aware of is that much of this site is actually not original, as many restorations have been done going back several decades. So what you see here now is simply not what it looked like whenever it was constructed thousands of years ago. In fact, the winged bulls were found buried in dirt and mud, and then moved into place as you now see them here. This is another detail that leads me to think that they may have been Sumerian or perhaps pre-Sumerian, relics of a civilization that was wiped out by the so-called Great Flood that undoubtedly swept this area long ago. I mean, for something that is this sophisticated, make no mistake, bronze tooling could not have carved these, especially with this precision. I was amazed when I saw and touched these with my own hands and noticed that these statues were carved out of a massive block of quartzite, which is even harder than granite. Although keep in mind that many of the Lamassu that have been found have been made of different stone materials. Not all were granite or quartzite. Now, these pictures aren't particularly high in megapixel resolution, but if you look closely, the fine details of the feathers, the beard, and everything else is truly astounding work. Anyone doing this today would utilize diamond bit drills and composite materials, and not to mention lasers and machine routers operated by a computer. Without a doubt, there is certainly more to this story than what academics have concluded. I was able to take these photos while on mission to the nearby Iraqi police station, which is located in front of this gate on the other side of the street a few hundred meters away. Just look at how tall these are. I'm 5'10" without shoes, and as you see me here in the photo, I'm wearing boots and this Kevlar helmet, certainly putting me over 6 feet tall in the photo. And I'm probably, what, half its height? In fact, look at this comparison of one that's in a museum and compared to this lady standing next to it. Truly massive. Also, take a moment to check out this ancient stone ramp that leads up to the Nagal Gate. I can only imagine the history of this place. What ancient armies may have marched up it, and whoever else from the various Assyrian, Babylonian empires that once occupied this territory? And did Jonah from the Old Testament walk up this very entrance? Did King Sargon of Akkad walk up this very ramp? It's fun to think about. Now, I have another video clip like I mentioned. Forgive me again for the low quality and shaky camera. It's not easy being a tourist in Iraq when you have 60 pounds of gear, including weapon and ammo and everything else, as well as the lingering thought that there could be snipers and anyone else in the area. So forgive me for the shaky camera, but check out this short clip now.
Yeah, we're tourists in Iraq.
Of course, I wish I could go back in time and buy a better camera and take better quality shots, but ultimately, I'm so thrilled that I was able to visit this site while it still existed. Because unfortunately, these were destroyed a few years ago. It's incredible that these are the same exact ones that I saw and touched in the same spot, but I must say, that is so upsetting to see that this entire area has been obliterated. Those who destroyed it utilized earth-moving machinery and razed all of it to the ground. Every bit of it. The walls, statues, and everything else. Even look at updated satellite imagery that shows that this entire ancient historical site has been erased forever. All we have left now are the before and after photos. Yeah, upsetting. Now, I mentioned about 2 years ago in my Sumerian video that I would make a video involving my military as well as Iraq deployment experience and explain what made me enlist in the first place, why did I volunteer to go to Iraq, and I haven't made that video because it's very controversial. I have many thoughts on it, and it ties into personal issues, you know, political, historical, like it's a controversial thing on the things that I'm going to discuss with you because I'm pretty sure you're going to hear it in a way that you've never heard anyone else discuss it. I mean, when I went over there, I enlisted because I wanted to be a liberator for the Iraqi people. I worked with a guy who was a refugee from Iraq, and his story was incredible. His older brother had been killed by Saddam, not personally, but It's a whole long story, and I was very encouraged to go over there and do the right thing. And what I learned when I was there, that war is just not what you think it is. It's not what you were sold on what it is. It's not what I was sold. And my perspective leaving was profoundly different. So I'll stop myself there. I'm going to make the video. It probably won't be my very next video, and I apologize for not making it sooner like I said I would. But again, it's a touchy subject. I don't know what YouTube will think of it. I don't know what other people think of it. And ultimately, I just have to speak my own truth and not give a crap what other people think, right? So again, it may not be my next video, but I am going to make it, and I'm going to make it soon. But I'm going to stop myself there. This is getting a bit long. If you haven't already, follow me on Instagram and Twitter. I'm enjoying posting things about me and this channel, different clues for upcoming videos, as well as little things about my personal life. So check that out. But yeah, hit the like button, subscribe, and leave a comment. Let me know what your thoughts are on all of this. There's so many different things I discussed in this video. But again, I'm Jimmy. This is Bright Insight. Take care, everybody. Look forward to a new video here in just the next few weeks. I already have a few good ones planned, so you'll be seeing me sooner than it was than from the previous video. But I'll leave it at that. Take care, everybody.